My name is Christian Henkel. I'm working at the Fraunhofer IPA, and I want to present to you a little project that I made. In fact, it's open source. It's on GitHub as we speak, and this little line says it already, but I think we can still go a little bit more into detail. First, let me tell you a little bit why I made this stuff. I started at IPA, I think, a little more than 3 years ago, and I started in a, let's say, cloud background. So I'm working in the department that runs our production cloud and builds our production cloud, but I have a strong robotics background, and so what you will hear here today is a little bit what I learned, what is necessary to bring cloud into robotics during these past 3 years, because now I will be moving away from IPA, and this is a little tiny part of what I think should help every one of you, which was the single most useful tool in my job so far. Let me give you a little bit of an introduction into this term of cloud robotics. Of course, this is could be also the title of this whole session. In some sense, you still have to speak about it. In some sense, I think you still have to say what you mean when you say cloud robotics, and what I mean is making use of centralized computational resources in robotics or in robotics use cases. And so on the left side, you see what cloud is, so something like unlimited computational powers, distributed systems. And if you think about ROS can already do a lot of that out of the box. ROS can especially have these distributed systems. You can also shift these nodes to other places. Especially when we're looking at ROS 2, I think this would get more on a momentum. But there's an open challenge, and this is the deployment. And when you look back on the left side, something that also belongs to cloud-based computing or cloud-based system is on-demand services, is that you can choose a service to run, you can be built for this service, and this is something that's not working in ROS per se. So that's what I'm going to address. I want to give you an example of one of these cloud robotics use cases. It's our cloud navigation. It's in fact an earlier version. What I'm showing you now is an earlier version of what you will see in the afternoon at our institute and also tomorrow in the talk by my colleague Felipe. What we have done is basically connected many robots together in terms of navigation. So we can run the global planner of all of these robots in the cloud and can run the local planner on the robots. On top of that, we also have a holistic environment model. This is basically the SLAM map for all robots. And we can also include external sensors into the system. As I said, you will see this in action this afternoon and hear more about this in the morning. I was in this project the cloud guy. I was in this project the guy that had to make sure that everything runs, that the stuff runs in the cloud, that the stuff runs on the robots. You see that last year we published a paper on this, but soon after that we started to work on industrial deployments of this whole system. And when you want to have industrial deployments, then we used our virtual Fort Knox cloud-based platform. This is what I said, I'm working on most of my time at IPA. So we can deploy stuff in the cloud. We have in the marketplace, we can buy services and can deploy them into cloud. We can integrate the stuff on the robot. In fact, we are doing this with ROS, of course. We can integrate the services from the robot into the cloud. We do this with our client for Virtual Fort Knox that will also be released soon, not at the moment, but soon, open source, probably by the end of this year. But again, open point is the robot deployment. This is not really so much of an issue if you're looking at some kind of academic system. There is maybe one robot in the corner that still runs Indigo, and the other robot in that corner that you have to log into some special SSH account of this and that colleague, because only that's the place where software is running. In an academic system, that's okay. You can still run it. You will still be able to run some kind of demonstration on a trade fair with that kind of stuff. But if you're looking into a industrial application, and that's the whole reason why I'm presenting it here at the ROS Industrial Conference, you have to look into more detail. How do you bring the software to the robots? How do you make sure that all the software and all robots is the same? How do you make sure that you can easily update the software and that it's running robustly. For this one, I first have to introduce a little bit of some Docker terms. I say Docker is probably not the only solution out there. There's stuff like Snap and other solutions. But at the time, Docker was, or Docker still is probably the thing that most people use, at least it feels like. And I want to introduce some terms that come up in, when you talk about Docker, just because these are not familiar to everyone. So like an image is something that contains a binary in all its dependencies, and it's a VM, but not. You can think of it a lot like a virtual machine, but in fact, it's of course no virtual machine. These Docker images run on your actual Linux kernel, and they simply contain the binary with all dependencies, as I said. The Dockerfile is the way to define these images, and an important point is that these images are defined incrementally. So you can see one of those Dockerfiles on the right side. For example, I'm having some kind of base image, which are of course provided by the OSRF, and then you define a series of changes to this image, and at the end, you end up with your image that, in this case, for example, runs some kind of ROS binary, some kind of ROS node. In terms of Docker terms, we need also the term registry. Registry would be something like a repository where you can put all your images, and there's also a public version, which most of you will know, the Docker Hub, but you can also run your private registry, which is of course important if you're dealing with confidential code or closed source. A container you would call a running image, and a Docker host would be a place to run such an image, especially if you use only Docker. This Docker host is then remotely accessible so that you can, for example, run the software on the robot. Another option I have to mention would be Kubernetes. Kubernetes is, if you look at it from this way, a replacement for the Docker host in this sense. And as you will hear in the talk of the Google colleagues later, you could also use basically the images that you create with this tool with the Google Cloud on your Kubernetes cluster that's running there or running on your robot. So, again, coming back to this catch line, simply running ROS nodes in Docker containers on remote robots. And here, simply, I mean simply in two terms or in two regards. First regard is user experience. It should be simple to run these Docker containers. And it's also not much. There's not much to it. It's only a plumbing between these two systems, a plumbing between ROS and Docker. And that's also what makes this tool very light and very usable. So you can find the tool on GitHub, as I said. It's currently a little bit in the middle of the release process, but at some point it will also be, probably with the next sync, it will also be available as a Debian package, at least for Kinetic for now. It's BSD licensed. It's a re-implementation from Zero, so we took a lot of these things we learned with this before. We had a lot of scripts and a lot of tooling and a lot of learnings before, and we managed to bring this down to a currently at least under 1,000 lines of code tool that can do this stuff for you. It's currently a library, as I said, a library that allows you to run ROS nodes in Docker containers on remote robots. It has a command line interface, but it is of course also open to other interfaces, and you are very welcome to implement them. If we look at the architecture, that's why I introduced the phrases earlier. On your server, which can be also, for example, your laptop, you have the Dockerfile that defines your image. You can then push the image to the registry, and the registry and then the robot can pull this image from the registry. But all the user sees is a simple command, in this case, docker ros run, ros run, some kind of package, some kind of binary. And all the rest is handled for you. As I said, there's a command line interface currently. This command line interface supports four different subcommands. You can either build the image, you can run an image, you can stop a running image, and you can push these images to the registry. These subcommands are the same subcommands you would use in Docker yourself. This makes it accessible for people that are already used to Docker. Generally, I can support either user-defined packages, so packages that are in your current workspace, or system packages that are defined on a system. And you can also give user-defined Docker files, but, and a lot of the engineering went into them, we also have default Docker files that will just work with these two variants of images. I said command line interface is one use of the library. We also made another use, which was this GUI interface. Basically, on the left side of the GUI, you could see the images that are available, on, and on the right side, the robots, and then you could just drag and drop these images to the robot. But this was more of a proof of concept, and I did not publish this GUI at the moment with the stuff because, yeah, for developers, it's more useful to have a command line tool, and so we put most of the development into the command line tool. You will still find it in some branch, I think, if you're really interested. But we mostly made it to approach the industry and to show it in a more hands-on way. Yeah, and DockerOS is part of this. So on the bottom line, I think I showed to you how you can simply run ROS nodes in containers on robots. Future work, of course, feel free to use the library for anything else, integrate it in anything else. I think it would be also a really good idea to integrate it deeper into ROS launch so that you can, for example, define a launch file that then installs, that then, for example, launches a Docker container on a robot or something like this, similar to the machine tag that is there currently, but only few people use them, use it. Of course, ROS 2 is an open point for me, unfortunately, at the moment. Yeah, we're taking pull requests, and if you have any other questions, feel free to contact me. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Christian. Are there immediate questions? Yeah, I see one here and the other one on the other side. So.
Hi, that looks like a really nice tool. Do you have any experience in terms of, is there any performance loss on the robots when you're running something through Docker instead of natively?
I mean, the overhead of Docker is very small. I have had no issues where I would say it was slower in the Docker container. It depends a lot on your tools, on your, yeah.
Because but I read some studies that showed that especially on the networking, Docker is introducing delays if you have this network virtualization, and we're doing a lot of like talking with robots over the network and components over the network.
I mean, yeah, real-time communication should never really run over ROS communication anyway, so yeah, it really depends on your application.
Lars König from Qt. I see many activities on this containerized solutions on embedded devices or out in the edge, Resin.io, Foundries, you may know them. But the question, two questions actually, why ROS specific? So is there any reason for that? And the second question, how reliable is that? Is it production ready? So what's the bandwidth with the Delta updates, etc.?
On the first question, it is ROS-specific because it's a ROS tool. I mean, you could generate Docker images out of anything. It's just a tool to create Docker images. It's just bridging the gap between ROS and Docker. You could do the same thing with any other Docker image if you want to. On the second question, reliability, as I said, we used technologies like this for robust industrial applications, but the tool as it is now is not stable in that industrial sense at the moment. Yeah, but of course we are working towards that.
Okay. Maybe a short question and also a short answer, Christian.
Sure.
Yeah. So what is the experience using USB devices like a camera or an Arduino? Do you have any experience using Docker and giving the permissions to them?
Yeah, that's definitely possible. You can just import them, like include them as a device. Thank you.
Very good. Then again, thank you very much, Christian.